body or in spirit and join me in the call to worship from Psalm 26, the psalm appointed for today. Speak on my behalf, O Lord, for I would choose the path of integrity, trusting your love without wavering.
Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and mind.
As your steadfast love guides me, let me live in faithfulness to you.
O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell, and the place where your glory abides.
Keep me always in your presence, ever ready to praise your name. Fulfill your promise and be gracious to me.
I shall ever bless you, O loving presence, our beloved Lord.
Let us worship God together with our opening hymn, number 339 in your hymn book, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Remind us that each of us is your child. We are all
Christ invites us to his table on this World Communion Sunday. Remind us that your people from all over the world are also at your table. As we are fed, lead us forward to care for all your children. Amen. We've made the confession of the church. Let us make the confession of our own hearts in a time of silence. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, hear the good news. God promises us new life, new strength, new hope, and in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day, the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him, destroyed it for no reason." Then Satan answers the Lord, "Skin for skin, all that people have they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he's in your power, only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job, from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God, and not receive the bad? Yet all this Job did not sin for his lips. Here ends the reading. As it is, We do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. Here ends the reading.
So now we have time for our kids, and I invite the kids to come and meet me at the set. We all want to know about God. We all want to follow in God's way. And when we make friends with our brothers and sisters around the world, we find out we have more in common than the ways that we are different. So let's have a prayer. Dear God, thank you that you sent Jesus into the world to show us how to live, to teach us that you love every single one of us, to help us remember that we are all part of your family. We pray for our Christian friends around the world, especially the Redemption Church, the Greenwich Meridian Church, and the Victory Climbing Church in Ghana, and the Monte de los Olivos Church in Guatemala. Put Jesus' peace into our hearts and into our world today. Help us to be peacemakers. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thanks for coming down. You get to go to Sunday school with Mrs. O'Shea. We're going to stand and sing our praise for hearing God's word. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Here ends the reading. May God bless us with understanding. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In today's scripture, Jesus' disciples ask him about divorce. They remind him that Moses made rules that allowed for divorce. Hebrew law permitted a man to divorce his wife. Of course, it was a different culture with different rules and understandings about marriage. In Jesus' time, marriage and divorce were matters between men. Fathers gave their daughters to be married as a business transaction between families. And divorce could be initiated only by the husband. In Jewish law, even adultery was something that happened between men. If a husband was with another woman, he was not said to have committed adultery against his wife. Rather, he was said to have committed adultery against the other married man. Jesus' response to the laws of marriage and divorce is that God never intended for such hardness of heart and mind. He refers to a passage in Genesis that is best translated, "The two persons, man and woman, enter into a common human life and social relationship because they are created as equals." Jesus emphasizes this intent for equality, saying that what God has joined together, no one should separate. In other words, no one should split husband and wife apart so that one becomes greater than and the other one becomes less than. Instead, both persons are made in God's image, and as one flesh, they hold equal rights and bear equal responsibility for their actions and decisions. Because the laws of that time were not equal, Jesus shows how women were vulnerable at the mercy of the men who were closest to them. In Genesis, we see that God created the world to be whole and to live in harmony. And we also see that human beings were not able to let it be that way. From the beginning, we decided not to listen to God's ways and instead take the attitude of we should be able to do whatever we want, whenever we want. So there are many situations of brokenness in this world because of human actions. Divorce is one type of brokenness. The reading ends with Jesus receiving little children. The disciples evidently saw them as a nuisance and wanted to send them away, but Jesus refused. Instead, he welcomed them, blessed them, hugged them. And Jesus says in all of this, the kingdom of God is being made manifest. Not just the realm of God, the kingdom of God, but the very nature of God is being demonstrated in welcoming those little children. Jesus is telling us that God is the one who brings people together and refuses to send little ones away. Now, normally we read this passage as applying to and being about us, human beings. We say, well, here Jesus is teaching about divorce and how we should think about divorce, and Jesus is teaching us about the need to welcome and bless little children. And that is a perfectly fine and appropriate way to read the passage. But really, the scriptures are meant to tell us about God, about who God is, and what God is like. So might we also read this passage in a way that is more about God than about us? If we can see this passage through the lens of what does it tell us about God, we might find this reading is about the great difference between God and ourselves. We human beings have our limits. We make promises, usually with all good intentions to keep them. In the case of marriage, we promise to stay together forever. But people get sick, people get hurt, people get disappointed or disappoint. People become stuck or trapped or addicted, or distant, or estranged. People change, or they don't change, or they try desperately to keep anything from changing. In other words, life happens. Nobody I know wants brokenness or advocates divorce as a general rule. But human beings have limits. Sometimes we find it impossible to keep the promises that we've made. Sometimes promises get broken for all kinds of good reasons. we look at the second part of the lesson, we can say that we love children. We love how cute they are. We love how they help us to see the world through fresh eyes. We love how spontaneous and loving they can be. But be honest, children are very demanding. To bring children into the world is to severely limit your own adult freedom. Children demand time and energy. Children have to be cared for. Little children are utterly dependent on others to do the things they cannot yet do for themselves. So in both parts of this reading, we see that human beings have limitations. Our relationships might fail. Children can change our lives in ways we never could have predicted. Human relationships in general are unpredictable. And because of them, we may find ourselves in situations where we are hurt and broken. But in today's gospel, Jesus makes clear in the strongest possible terms that God does not have those same limitations that we humans have. God is the one who, from the very beginning, made union and communion, togetherness and relationship as part of this creation. God is the one who connects individuals. God is the one who created us to be in community together. That's how the church was created. Jesus gathered up all of these different individuals, these fishermen, tax collectors, zealots, peacenicks. Those disciples were not all of one stripe or one way of thinking or being. Jesus gathered them up, and together they followed him. It's the same for us now. He brings us together in this community with all of our different ideas, different opinions, different experiences, different perspectives, to be in communion together in this church. Furthermore, God is the one who enables us not only to bring little ones into the world, but also to expend ourselves for their care. In every church congregation, we take responsibility for children who are not our biological children, but are given to us as a gift of the families who bring them, a gift from God too. We are human beings, and so we have limits on our love, and sometimes that is appropriate. Let me be clear in saying that God in no way expects any of us to stay in a situation where there is hurt or denigration or abuse. We have limits on our ability to stay with other people and to keep our lives bound to theirs. When anger or shaming or threatening or hurting become part of a relationship, it has to stop. And sometimes the only way to do that is to end the relationship. But this human reality of brokenness is set alongside a counter-truth. The love of God does not have such limits. We can attempt to separate ourselves from God, but Jesus implies here that God never separates from us. We may come to the limit of our human ability to love and persevere in a relationship with others, but God will never reach those limits. Here in the Gospel of Mark, we are on our way seeing just how much God loves us, just how far God in Christ will go for us. And that is all the way to death on a cross. So Jesus, in this passage, is trying to teach us about God's love. Jesus says those who follow him are able to have love, compassion, mercy for the needs of those who are vulnerable, whether they are children, or those who are destitute, or those who are mentally disabled, or those who are sick, or those who are grieving, or those who have no home, or those who have been devastated by forces far beyond human control. He says those who are broken in any way deserve our help and our compassion. There are so many ways we humans fail to live up to the ways of God's kingdom because we have our limits. But spread like a banner over everything is the affirmation that God loves us, limited human beings, in a limitless and divine way. We may fail, but we have a God who forgives our failures, who loves us despite our limits, to love in return. So when we look at this passage through that lens, we find it is not rigid bad news of setting moral standards so high that we could never possibly keep them. Instead, today's gospel is good news that despite our inabilities, our limits, and our failures, our God is limitlessly loving and always and ever faithful. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn is number 440 in your hymn book, Jesus, Lover of My Soul.
Jesus, Lord of my soul, grant me to
a few items going on for minute permission. First, of course, the devastation from Hurricane Helene and Presbyterian disaster assistance is always on the ground in the midst of those disasters. So there is an announcement at the back of your bulletin that explains how to give if you want to call or if you want to go online. You can also write a check to our church and just put in the memo that is for hurricane relief, and we'll send that to them for you. But there's also an address here if you'd like to send a check directly. Second, we have our fall clothing drive that started today. There's a big box in the lobby to receive donations of, Jane, is this right, men's and women's and children's clothes? Yes, so all of those that are in good shape, fall and winter, please feel free to bring those in through the month of October. And they will be going to support St. Peter's Hospital Thrift Shop, the Patients in Need Closet at Memorial Hospital, and also some of the shelters in Albany. So feel free to bring those in all month. And then lastly, our October mission is for the Peace and Global Witness offering. You see the envelopes in your bulletin today, and also an insert talking about the work of peacemaking throughout the world. 25% of the donations that we get stay local, and ours will go to Five Rivers as a way of making peace with the earth. So lots of ways to reach out for mission this month. Let us gather all of our prayers together, calling to mind those that we have named and those who are in the tender silence of our hearts. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, for your love that breaks through barriers and boundaries that we set against one another and even ourselves. We thank you for the life of Jesus Christ, who showed us the heights and depths of your power in this world. We thank you that your love cannot be defeated by anything we know. We thank you for this day when we can gather and meet together, for this place where faith has been nurtured and hope has been revealed for generations. Oh God, in this time we pray for the world that you love, especially the places where there is conflict, poverty, hunger, or hostility. We pray for war-torn lands, for soldiers who fight for high ideals, for innocent victims whose lives are torn apart. We pray especially for the people of Israel, Gaza, Lebanon, and Ukraine. We pray for people everywhere who are crushed by the unending cycle of human violence. And we pray for peacemakers who spend their lives speaking truth and fostering reconciliation. We pray for all of those who suffer in body or mind, for those who are in hospitals and nursing homes, for those who are in prison, for those who are imprisoned by addiction, for those who live without hope, for those who are mourning, and for those who wait. We pray for those who suffer because of their gender, or their race, or their social status, or their age, or their heritage, or their abilities, or their religion. We pray for the transformation of our human ways, that we may find the ability to let go of the things whose time has passed, that we may find the courage to take on the things whose time has come, that we may find the compassion to reach for the things whose time is now. Guide our steps to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, and hear us as we join our voices to say the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us be invited to our giving with words from Scripture. From the book of Deuteronomy, it says, "Remember the Lord your God,
for For it is God who
gives you the ability to produce wealth.
Giving is an act of faith. We have been sharing stories of the impact our church has on us and on other people. And this morning I just want to share a few thoughts from someone who grew up in this church, is now a leader in another worshiping community. They sent us a donation toward our steeple and roof project, remembered the generations of their family buried in the cemetery around the church and behind the church. They noted what a blessing it is for us to have an active Sunday school as a sign of God's continuing new life. They commented on the adjustments we've all had to make in a post-pandemic world, moving things to meeting online. God has been faithful in helping us to stay connected as we walk in the footsteps of our Lord. And they closed by saying, in faith and hope, we support the New Scotland Church because God is not finished with us yet. God willing, we will all be together for our church's 250th anniversary. God established our church under an oak tree 237 years ago, calling the faithful through all of those generations. And indeed, God is not finished with us yet. So the offering plates are at the back of the aisles. You can use the QR code in your bulletin. You can go to our website, newscotlandpc.org, anytime to support God's ministry in this place. I don't think we mentioned at the top during the announcements, but we are still collecting donations for our Raise the Roof and Steeple projects. I think most of you know that the steeple work is done, the chimney work is done, and Pinnacle Roofing will be here on Tuesday to put a new roof on for us. So when you come next Sunday, you should see a fresh new face on our church building. We give because we know everything that God has given to us, and we are so grateful that we cannot help but give more into the world. So let us stand and sing our praise to God with the words of the doxology. So our liturgy is on the insert of your bulletin. Please join me in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for the creation you made that you called good. For the beauty that surrounds us each and every day as we look to your sky, to your trees, to your plants and animals, and into the faces of one another as we look for your spark that you called everything good. We ask that you bless this time and bless these elements. Help us, O God, to be connected to the long generations of people that have come before, who have felt your spirit moving among us, who have called us to come together in worship, in love, in forgiveness, in praise, in service. And hear us as we join our voices with the faithful of every time and place and all of creation, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We remember, O God, that when Jesus sat at the table with his disciples, he took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Holy God, we ask that your spirit will move among us, that you will bless this bread and cup, that it may be the body and blood of Christ for us. And bless us, that as these elements are changed into us, so we may be changed into you, bone of your bone, flesh of your flesh, loving and caring in the world, so that all may see we are followers of Jesus Christ, and we long to do his work in the world, bringing love and welcome and peace and justice wherever we go. Let us join together in the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God, be with us until we are together again to sit at the table in your heaven, in your glory, where we may praise you without end, singing our praises of what a wonderful God you are, how we have known you in this life, how we have shared that wonder with others, and how we are gathered together in that place. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, all glory and praise and honor belong to you, O God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So if you will take your cup so the juice is on the bottom, and peel off the little top. I hope you have a cracker. Everybody have a cracker as you're ready to take and eat the bread of heaven. And when you're ready, you can flip the cup over so the juice is on the top and pull back that tab. Take and drink the cup of new life. These cups will fit in a little rack in front of you in the pew, and if you would take them with you as you leave, there's a trash can in the hallway for these next to a recycle bin for your bulletin. So please join me in the prayer after communion. O God, you are one God. You have opened wide your hands and fed us with one food, that we may be one. You have filled us with your presence, that we may be one. You have showered on us your spirit, that we may be one. You in Christ, and Christ in us, that all may be one. Send us into the world as your servants, on fire with the Spirit, that the world may know that you love them through Jesus Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 188 in your hymn book, Jesus Loves the Little Children.
Jesus loves me.
Oh. Jesus loves me.
Jesus.
and brothers in Christ, held in the arms of our loving God, go into the world with renewed courage and kindness to live fully out of your Christian faith. And may the enfolding love of God, the captivating beauty of Christ, and the endless wonderment of the Spirit uphold you and sustain you until we meet again. Amen.
Strength and courage.